Hi guys, my name is Sanka. I'm like running the head of product at Babylon. So this talk is going to be about pitching Bitcoin staking and how the Babylon team is looking to execute this product over the next 6 months. Babylon is bringing Bitcoin security to the app chain universe. As we know, like Cosmos is a big app chain universe. IBC has enabled a lot of interoperability within the Cosmos ecosystem. So I want to kind of go a little slower in what does it mean to bring Bitcoin security to the app chain universe? And how did this journey start? So the Babylon team is headed by Professor David Say out of Stanford University. His specialty is cryptography and consensus algorithm. So roughly a year ago, Cosmos had a lot of different very high value chains like Terra, and Terra is based on Cosmos SDK, where the Cosmos SDK has this 21-day unbonding period. So one of the issues which Cosmos validators face is when they lock their assets on the Cosmos ecosystem, these 21 days is a big form of capital inefficiency for these validators. So if you have a stablecoin and it starts depegging, then the validators are kind of stuck with this illiquidity. And one aspect for Babylon was, is there a way for us to reduce this unbonding period, which is there in Cosmos, which is 21 days? And initially, the thought leaders of Cosmos approached David, and they wanted to see that, can we come up with a solution for reducing this unbonding period for Cosmos SDK, which in Cosmos SDK, it's 21 days. And we felt that the first achievement of Babylon was that we introduced this decentralized trust source, which is Bitcoin, where we were able to reduce the unbonding period of 21 days down to a day for Cosmos. So right now, we have 34 chains in the Babylon ecosystem, which is timestamping. The word timestamping is that when you have a proof of stake chain, proof of stake has a defined problem in the nomenclature, which is called the long range attack. I want to kind of spend 1 minute explaining what this means. So because in proof of stake, the validators have to bond the capital for 21 days, once a validator chooses to leave the proof of stake system, which is considered as unbonding, that period of 21 days is used to create a social consensus between the protocol and the other remaining validators to see that this validator who is actually leaving the system does not act as a bad actor. What could be a bad actor is that when he unbonds his capital, he can try to spin up his own chain and he can try to create a separate parallel chain where in the long run, he wants to convince the delegator that his own chain is the real chain rather than the chain from which he has bonded. So this is called a long-range attack. So we have used this Bitcoin timestamping algorithm to help proof-of-stake systems get an additional form of trust from Bitcoin where we are able to go to the next point, which is solving this unbonding problem and reducing it from the 21 days down to a day. So we used Osmosis as the first protocol where we went in and we ran a governance proposal to ask the validators in the Osmosis ecosystem that if we are able to deliver this reduction of the unbonding period, would they appreciate that? And we did a lot of work, the Babylon team did a lot of work in interacting with every ecosystem partner in Osmosis, and we were able to pass that governance proposal with 99.62% agreement that this is something which would have massive value to the Osmosis ecosystem. So while we were doing this Bitcoin timestamping algorithm, we have to understand that what is the benefit when we implement this algorithm to the Bitcoin ecosystem. So fundamentally, the benefit which we found to the Bitcoin ecosystem was that the miners get a certain fees from the timestamping protocol. It's not a lot of fees, but it's still some amount of benefit we bring to the Bitcoin miners. But one of the things we try to understand in the Bitcoin ecosystem is like, who are these participants in the Bitcoin ecosystem? They're miners as well as the Bitcoin holders. So if you take the miners and the Bitcoin holders, that's where you're actually looking at an addressable market of 500 billion. So the next step for us to move from Bitcoin timestamping to the Bitcoin staking was we wanted to include the Bitcoin holders into this journey. And Babylon's Bitcoin staking protocol is to include not just the miners, but also the holders, so that now we have both the participants in the Bitcoin ecosystem who is ready to give their capital to secure the security budget of POS. So we are very excited about this project because we think a lot of the POS chains, they overinflate their security budget, and as a result, it's a damage for the utility of the token. So we are seeing tremendous reception from utility-based tokens, work-based tokens, who think that Bitcoin offers them a cheaper cost of capital, so they can get Bitcoin secured, they can secure their ecosystem by aligning with Bitcoin, and then they can really focus in defining the utility of their token. So why do we think Bitcoin staking is such an important milestone for Babylon? As I said, that Bitcoin is, as an asset class, is around $500 billion. And over post the Bitcoin white paper coming, there has been some initiatives in trying to bring real use cases to Bitcoin. And one of the key attributes of Bitcoin is the Bitcoin holders don't like additional trust assumptions. And there is a very famous, I sometimes mess up the statement, is like, not your keys, not your assets. So that basically embodies the principle that if you are trying to create a side chain or you're trying to create a roll-up with additional assumptions, those activities have not been able to succeed. So for us in Babylon, we try to make sure that we don't create another protocol which inserts new trust assumptions. Babylon is actually the first Bitcoin protocol which is trying to bring use case to Bitcoin without inserting any new trust assumptions. Second, we have actually looked at the wrapped Bitcoin market, and we see that the wrapped Bitcoin market, people who put their Bitcoin in the wrapped Bitcoin, they only deserve or they only expect 2 to 3% yield. That's actually a lot lower yield expectation than any of the proof of stake yield expectations. So we think that if Bitcoin capital is available to POS systems, they would demand a lot less staking rewards. And as a result, what's going to happen is these proof of stake systems can really focus to use their token supply to grow their own ecosystem. We also know from all the assets in the crypto universe, Bitcoin is actually the least volatile asset, and that helps you to reduce the volatility of your security budget. Finally, what if you bring Bitcoin to a new POS system? We have found that you're actually distributing the rewards, which generally goes to the native token. Now you're able to distribute the rewards to the native token holders as well as the Bitcoin holders, and the Bitcoin holders are heavily decentralized. So what you're doing in giving out these staking rewards, you're ensuring that your token is actually a lot more decentralized and widespread. So all these attributes help to think that Bitcoin staking is actually going to be a very important use case for POS system in the coming years. So as we said, that we actually talked, like there's a light paper online and there's also some other white papers we have on our website. So fundamentally, all this sounds really good. But as I said, that the Bitcoin community is very conservative. So are we able to bring our ideas to execution? And so some of these attributes which we are talking about is when you bring the Bitcoin capital to a POS system, your staking capital is a first-class citizen, just like the native token. So there is no preferential treatment in the POS system for this additional capital. So the Bitcoin holders can actually be very comfortable that you get the same treatment in allocating this capital to the security budget. Second is, fundamentally, Bitcoin is a very limited scripting language. It's not Turing complete. So one of the key milestones or achievements from the Babylon team, and I would say a lot of this Babylon team is here in the audience, we also have our co-founder Fisher joining this conference, is we have been able to cryptographically emulate the slashing criteria, which is there in POS, into the Bitcoin. And I would like you guys to listen to the videos, which are they're online. We talk a lot. We actually even have a forum where we are discussing the different aspects of this cryptographic signatures of how it would execute slashing on Bitcoin. The second part is we are enabling trustless staking, meaning if you are a Bitcoin holder, you're not including any additional trust assumptions. You can actually delegate your Bitcoin to a validator, and that validator can actually validate for you. And there is actually an unbonding algorithm where you will be very comfortable in knowing that if you lock your Bitcoin, how do you unbond in case you don't want to be in the system? And finally, we are also trying to create capital efficiency. The idea here is if you bring a certain capital using Bitcoin, you can not just stake in one ecosystem or one blockchain, but you can use that capital in other blockchain. So there is a restaking enabling through this framework. So fundamentally, the biggest achievement, I would say, in terms of Babylon, we are not incorporating any additional trust, and we are the first protocol to design slashing on Bitcoin. So we feel very good about this. We are getting a lot of reception on different chains to be looking to adopt this Bitcoin staking. So right now on the timestamping, we have, it's actually 32 tokens we have timestamped on the Cosmos ecosystem. We are actually talking to Polygon and Arbitrum for some adoption. This is a roadmap. So fundamentally, we had the Bitcoin timestamping testnet where we were able to get adoption from roughly 32 to 34 chains in the Cosmos ecosystem. We started the Bitcoin staking MVP. If you visit our booth right now, you'll be able to play with the MVP. We're planning to go to the testnet by the end of the year where we plan to have at least one or two POS systems which can give rewards to the Bitcoin holders. And we are looking to head to mainnet just before the Bitcoin halving. The reason we have this strategy is Bitcoin halving fundamentally reduces the rewards for the miners. So if we have a functional product, we expect the miners to be very excited about having these additional rewards coming to the Bitcoin holders. Initially, we are trying to address the security budget problem of POS systems because we think POS systems bootstrapping their security using native token creates a lot of volatility. The volatility influences the security of the system, which eventually influences the whole economy of that proof of stake system. So if proof of stake system adopts Bitcoin staking, we think the volatility of the security budget is going to be lower, and the users and the adopters of this POS chain would be a lot more focused on creating the utility and the economics of the token rather than being concerned about the security of the token. And finally, we have, and down post our mainnet, we do plan to launch a DA layer for rollups on the Bitcoin chain as well as on the horizontal side for the POS side. And if we are able to execute all this, fundamentally, we want to attack the core issue which most POS chains face is native Bitcoin liquidity. So that is a 1 year down the lane. We have a lot of roadmaps to hit, but we feel very comfortable, and I think we have a booth down there, so if anybody has any questions, happy to take into questions. Do I have any time to take questions? Okay, so. I guess no.
So. Sí.
Was that a signal to get off the stage or? Yeah.
So the security budget on the other chains would be, would still be in their native token, right? So how would you actually decrease the volatility of their security budget if they pay in their own token?
So ideally, the point we are making is that let's take the case of Osmosis, because we passed the governance proposal. Fundamentally, we are trying to say that if the Bitcoin holders lock the Bitcoin on the Bitcoin blockchain, and that capital is available for the Osmosis validators, they can use that capital. And fundamentally, the way the validators rewards works is, let's say we just have $100 as the security capital. Right now, that whole $100 is in native token, Osmo, right? Eventually, if Bitcoin staking is live, you can actually take, let's say, $40 in terms of Bitcoin and $60 in terms of Osmo. And now when the rewards are being paid, the ratio of that 4x10 goes to the Bitcoin side and 6x10 goes to the Osmo side. So in that way, what's happening is because the Bitcoin holders have a lower cost or lower yield expectation, as the Osmo protocol, you don't need to overinflate to give if it's $100 of Osmo, because generally you try to overinflate because if the token goes down, you don't want the validators to unbond.
I see. Yeah. So I have another question. How do the POS chains decide how much to pay for the security that's provided, which is probably, somewhat obfuscated by them, so they can't actually see how many Bitcoin are staked, I guess, and they would need an oracle to know what the Bitcoin are worth that are being staked. So how do they decide how much to pay out?
So so generally the way the inflation rewards get paid right now in POS, right, there's no oracle. It's basically the protocol decides that what's like the first year inflation. Sometimes in Cosmos, like an average is like 40% APR. So the protocol decides how much would be that inflation APR, but then if the amount of capital which is being staked, if a part of that capital is Bitcoin staked versus part of that capital is native staked, the protocol runs a governance proposal through its own community to see that what is an expected APR and what's a vesting schedule for this Bitcoin capital. So basically they're running like a proposal saying that we think we have cheaper cost of capital from the Bitcoin holder with an expectation of 10% yield, whereas our native holders are expecting 30% yield. We expect a distribution. This amount goes to the Bitcoin holders and this amount goes to the native token holders. Generally, the hypothesis we have is that the yield, that staking APR you have to give to the Bitcoin holders is going to be a lot lower than the native token because Bitcoin is a lot less volatile than the native token. But we leave the decision on the protocol. So the protocol runs a governance proposal and the protocol decides what is an expected APR over a certain period, and then they get to again revisit that post that performance.
I see that, yeah.
Okay, I guess if there's no questions, thank you.